Welcome back to Pulse Tech News. Today we bid farewell to August and usher in September with a long weekend, at least here in the US. Labor Day is Monday, where we honor the labor movement by not laboring and moving as little as possible. And with September's arrival, we can also start to pretend that it's fall now. But the tech news, Paul, get to the point, right? Well, I always keep it straight with you guys, and barring tech-related geopolitical stuff that I covered pretty heavily last week, and which is tiresome to say the least, things are fairly quiet. The summer lull that often hits the world of PC hardware seems to have lullified, or whatever lulls do, so today we're taking her easy for the dude and casually perusing some early Radeon RDNA 5 info, some Intel Nova Lake leaks, and some announcements from NVIDIA about next-gen Rubin. But we already know that's mostly focused on AI, so we can appraise it with haughty disdain. Congrats to everyone on making it two-thirds of the way through 2025. And now, it's time for tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Paul's Hardware Store on paulshardware.net, the only official source for Paul's Hardware merchandise, tantalizing t-shirts, brilliant beer sets, high-quality hoodies, and more, all featuring the classic thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers, or the 8-bit thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers who hate curves. New designs are added sporadically and at random, so head over to paulshardware.net and get some of that sweet, sweet merch right now. Or not right now, after you watch the video. Either way. Let's start with video cards. No, not AI ones, not even NVIDIA ones. AMD ones, the slightly more tolerable head of the three-headed GPU manufacturer Hydra. But to be clear, this info is sourced from notable leaker Kepler_L2, who posted homemade block diagrams to the AnandTech forums based on what they know about AMD's next-gen Radeon RDNA 5, also known as UDNA, GPU architecture. Could this be an actual high-end AMD GPU? Maybe. These groups of rectangles represent lots of things, but the smallest ones here are CUs, or compute units, and a group of six CUs makes up a shader engine along with a render backend, or RB unit, and two shader engines make up a shader array. So this largest of the four block diagrams that was shared shows 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 shader arrays, or 16 shader engines, with a total of 96 compute units. Also note the 16 32-bit memory controllers around the outside edge, meaning the max memory setup would connect via a 512-bit bus. Kepler shared four such block diagrams. There's a 40 compute unit configuration with six memory controllers for a 192-bit bus, and 24 CU and 12 CU variants for more entry-level GPUs that sport eight or four memory controllers respectively. Though here they might use 16-bit controllers, so the bus could be 64-bit, 128-bit, or 256-bit. This could lend credence to a recent rumor that AMD has entry-level RDNA 5 GPUs in the pipeline that will use low-power laptop VRAM, making up for slower speeds with additional bandwidth, which might be why the 24 compute unit design has 8 memory controllers, while the 40 CU one has 6. By comparison, the RX 9070 XT has 64 compute units and a 256-bit bus, although that's current-gen RDNA 4. But that should also remind us that the RX 9070 and 9070 XT still haven't come down to their originally proposed MSRPs to provide some serious competition for NVIDIA. But ignoring that, both the possibility of better entry-level GPUs with less expensive VRAM in the 12 and 24 CU setups, as well as the much-needed higher-end GPU that could be powered by that much larger 96 compute unit solution, would be very welcome video card alternatives to NVIDIA. That's assuming they can be priced well, and perhaps more importantly, actually sold for those prices, though. RDNA 5 GPUs are expected to go into mass production in Q2 of 2026, so they probably won't go out for sale until Q3 2026 at the earliest. Speaking of things we really hope will happen next year for the good of the PC gaming community, Intel, who seems to be maintaining business operations thanks at least in some part due to the government buyout last week, also seems to still have another generation of CPUs in development, codenamed Nova Lake, not to be confused with the refresh of current-gen Arrow Lake, which is also in the works. Both were referred to in a shipping manifest shared in a social media post by x86 Dead End Back, and just to get it out of the way, I'm not expecting the Arrow Lake refresh to cause much of a stir when those CPUs launch in late 2025. We'll get reheated leftovers that nobody liked in the first place, as they'll have the same architecture and core configuration as current-gen, possibly with a clock speed bump, though at the very least, they'll still still be LGA 1851 compatible. Intel's real answer to AMD's current dominance in desktop performance and gaming will come with Nova Lake, which was also listed in the manifest, and it's pretty clear these are 28-core parts, a bump up from Arrow Lake's 24-core CPUs like the 285K. They could still have just 8 performance cores though, which gaming performance is much more dependent on, but the true boost for gaming will likely come from the cache configuration as well as IPC gains via microarchitecture improvements and the move to Intel's 18A process, which is still apparently part of the plan. Arrow Lake, they ended up going to TSMC for fabrication, if you recall, but shipping manifest entries like these already showing up seem to show that Intel also realizes they have a lot riding on Nova Lake, and perhaps they are pushing to get those CPUs to market sooner rather than later. Their CFO David Zinsser at least seems to realize that Arrow Lake was a flop, so they're not deluding themselves as much as they used to. Now, Intel just needs to put that government money to good use. No, but not like that. No Intel. Speaking of the three GPU manufacturers in this timeline, let's move on to Nvidia news. Those Blackwell GPUs sure are selling well, despite all the anti-consumer ways in which the GeForce RTX 50 series was segmented and rolled out. Because what other choice do consumers have, really? I already complained about AMD's lack of competition, so how about something else? What comes after Nvidia's current Blackwell GPUs? Well, that would be Rubin, named for astronomer Vera Rubin, and Nvidia CEO Jensen Huang shared some updates on Rubin's progress with a group of doting journalists in Taiwan late last week. Like that guy seemed really, really enthused about what Jensen had to say. But TSMC will be fabbing the Rubin AI and presumably also GeForce Gaming chips for Team Green, as they did with Blackwell. And they've now taped out 6 chips in the Rubin family: a new CPU, GPU, scale-up NVLink switch, networking chip, networking switch, and a silicon photonics processor. Rubin is said to use a chiplet design with CoWoS-L packaging, where they put the chips on wafers and the wafers on substrate, and they're built on TSMC's 3-nanometer process. Rubin AI GPUs will be paired with the latest HBM4 memory, and maybe, someday, eventually, when Nvidia gets around to it, we'll hear more about those Rubin GPUs for gaming too. Expectations are low already on the gaming side though. I predict an 8GB RTX 6060 Ti that will be met with exasperation from enthusiasts and reviewers before inevitably climbing into the top 3 most used GPUs in the Steam hardware survey. And if we're lucky, there will only be 3 to 6 months of price gouging after launch, so consumers get to once again thank Nvidia extensively just for having GPUs to buy at MSRP, like I've been doing for the past couple months in GPU Price Watch. The remainder of the show, though, will be truncated due to the transition to tech briefs. I like secret code names, and particularly for PC hardware, learning them early gives one a special feeling of insight and privilege. So when this roadmap by OEM Celeno went live earlier this week and was shared by several reliable leakers on social media, my interest was piqued. This isn't straight from AMD, so grain of salt, but it looks like their mobile CPUs will be getting new versions based on 3nm Zen 6 in 2027, codenamed Gatorade, or Gator Range, assuming that's a typo, for the high-end, and Medusa Point for the premium tier. There will be a wide range of core and iGPU configurations, of course, but more importantly, do these code names sound codenamey enough? Medusa Lake and Gator Range sound dangerous, yes, but they also fall into the found on a map theme that Intel has fallen victim to for far too long. Forget getting stuck on 14nm, Intel has been stuck using Lake as a codename suffix since 2015. Skylake sounded pretty cool, but the mystique is long gone. Just drop the lake from all of these, and they're perfectly acceptable codenames, Intel, and then you'd at least catch up to AMD in one area. Next, let's ogle the most advanced water cooling setups in the world: data center water cooling. Now, you'd think the most expensive and high capacity data centers would avoid mixing water and electronics, but liquid has been used to cool enterprise hardware for just as long, if not longer, than home enthusiast PCs. And Google shared an update on their methods at Hot Chips 2025, as reported by Chips and Cheese. They use CDUs, or coolant distribution units, just like we saw on display from Cooler Master back at Computex, to transfer heat from each server's coolant loop to another facility-wide water supply that can also be externally chilled. Amazon uses a similar system in their data centers on a massive scale, and there's just something about the densely packed hardware, tubing runs, and specifically designed copper block assemblies in these units that stirs a primal hardware enthusiast part of me that has long slumbered. Google says their liquid-cooled fleet has 99.999% uptime since 2020, and perhaps most satisfying, not a bit of RGB to be seen in these rigs either. Speaking of cool stuff data centers get that I want for home PC use, even though most of the performance would be wasted, PCIe Gen 6 SSDs. Sure, it's been shown that for most home applications and gaming, an SSD upgrade doesn't do much once you have a decent Gen 3 M.2 NVMe drive installed, but enterprise storage keeps getting better. Case in point, South Korean manufacturer Fadu unveiled their latest Gen 6 SSD controller Wednesday with some impressive specs. It's called the Sierra FC6161 and can achieve 28.5 gigabytes per second read and write speeds, 6.9 million input-output operations per second, and up to 512 terabytes of capacity, all while consuming just 9 watts of power. By comparison, Gen 5 SSDs for enterprise use usually peak at around 14 gigabytes per second and 3.5 million IOPS, with power draw in the 10 to 20 watt range, and consumer Gen 5 drives that are somewhat notorious for hot running controllers might draw 6 to 8 watts. But I have complained about the apparent 4 terabyte ceiling for home PCs before, and I will continue to do so until we get 512 terabyte Gen 6 drives so our operating systems and games can load up faster than we can think. But I think that's going to do it for today's show. There you have it, guys, tech news for the week. And if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all of the articles that I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested. And you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.